People always think we're attacking NASA, and we're actually NASA enthusiasts when it comes right down to it, right? We're space enthusiasts. We want accountability. We want disclosure. We want to see what's actually there, and we will accept the limitations. We'll support the limitations on what's capable of doing. We don't need to keep researching in and find out, oh, all we're looking at is CGI. If you can't do it, say so.
It put an atom in a vacuum, and it has no energy. It will stay there, yeah, but nothing has no energy. It will start going about like crazy. All atoms go like that. They have some energy. Once they have some energy, if you try to confine them, they will start fighting against that confinement. So that is pressure. If you get a box with an atmosphere inside, with, you know, so many molecules that they do exert 10 tons of pressure on the wall, and then you put a vacuum, that wall is gonna really be not 10 tons. You can do wonders with the pressure. We get all sorts of machinery, you know, utilizing high pressures. The vacuum is something that not many people have in mind, but even the first experiments with vacuums had people flabbergasted because, you know, they had put two horses with two hemispheres. The first experiments, they were putting the two horses, you know, trying to separate those two hemispheres, and they weren't able to. So they started realizing, wow, you know, it's a lot of pressure. It's a lot of force for such a small area. And it comes down to being one atmosphere being 10 tons per square meter. 10,000 kilos is a lot. Most people bench press like 100 kilos, 80 kilos. 10 tons is a lot.
I think the average spacesuit for the Apollo program was 1.8 square meters of material. And the zipper is going to close and hold that together and not tear apart. Never mind the fact that it's not going to seal.
Let's make it easier for them. Suppose it was not one atmosphere. Suppose it was one tenth of the atmosphere. Still, we're talking about one ton. Not 10 tons per square meter, one ton. They were one-tenth of the pressure of the atmospheric pressure. Let's say they were economizing a lot. When you're talking about an almost perfect vacuum, the molecules will find their way to escape. They will. And the gas is much easier to find a hole to go through. Liquids, not so much. For example, when you build your vacuum chambers, I saw that you were using the vacuum vacs from an American guy. He makes nice vacuums, quite cheap. But that guy is using the water pumps for his outlets. That thing does not allow for a proper vacuum. Even that, can you imagine what a zipper would be like? It cannot use a proper tap. We have to be using needle valves. Needle valves are small, you know, the needles, and they don't allow air gas to pass so easily. For example, the compressed methane gas you get for your heater, that has a needle valve. It needs to be able to maintain the gas inside, and the gas will find a way to pass through. It will find, even if it has no holes, it will find a way. Some gases, like hydrogen, for example, atom is very small, will leak through even with no holes. It will start going through the crystal lattice.
I look at these videos with these fellows that repair air conditioning units, and they have that little sniffer to sniff that gas. And as soon as they find it, they'll spray some soapy liquid on there, and all of a sudden you start seeing these real small bubbles coming up. Any tiny little anything, that will, even the solder joints aren't done properly, or the gas comes right through.
Exactly.
So that means when you're doing a seal on your machine, even fingerprints can cause a problem. It has to be wiped perfectly clean.
Yes, the cleaning procedures are very thorough. You go through the ultrasonic cleaner, you try to have your lab as intact as you can, you know, even dusts. But what we do have as sealants between, you know, joints is not rubbers, but it's actually metal that you press, and it's a one-time only fix because it gets destroyed. If I were to have a zipper and be able to zip up my vacuum chamber with a nice zipper, I would be very happy, very happy. You cannot imagine what kind of extremes we have to go through to have a proper vacuum chamber. And I'll make a video showing the vacuum chambers, showing the parts, to just give the audience a bit of a feel of what is involved. You cannot be watching us at a zipper and expecting even rough vacuums to exist.
When they show the Apollo astronauts getting back onto the LEM, covered in dirt all over their suits, they're crawling across over top of a ceiling, shutting the door. There's absolutely no way that thing's going to work. There's no way that's going to seal.
If that thing was not going to seal anyways. Guys, you cannot seal something with holes like this big. If your vacuum chamber has the holes that they do get are invisible and you do get a hole and it's invisible, the zipper is perfectly visible. We're not talking about micron-sized or nano-sized holes. We're talking about a quarter of a millimeter. We're talking about sizable big holes. It is a joke. What was the fairy tale? The king is naked. Nobody was saying anything about it. Well, that's NASA. The king is naked in front of every scientist.
So the zipper on the back of the suit that they have on display, of course, the zipper is 2 inches short of coming all the way up to the collar. I mean, never mind the fact that the zipper is going to actually cold weld itself together.
Yeah, it is a joke. And every scientist that calls himself a scientist, especially those in material sciences that are very versed in vacuum chambers and all that technology, and they see, and you show them that suit, you show them the zipper, and then if they tell you, yes, I can tell you as a scientist that we can have a vacuum there, well, he does not have a conscience. He's lying, and he's deliberately lying. And generally, psychopathy starts from when you have to hide something. When you have to hide something, psychopathy starts. You have a problem. And it's enough is enough. All the scientists, we cannot be holding our breaths. New scientists have to come out. It is a goal to have a human on the moon. And America is stealing the dreams of people. And they're stealing also the tax money of their taxpayers. So yeah, you're dealing with them.
Yeah. Very good point you make there. Because when you've got people who are constricted by what they can say, because there are plenty of scientists at NASA. I mean, whether they're material scientists or atmospheric scientists or photographic scientists, doesn't matter what they are. They had to go along with the story that was being put out. We're going to land a man on the moon. And John Kennedy, who made the announcement, he didn't know what was going to happen, but we have to maintain John Kennedy's memory and we have to fulfill it. In order to do that, they had to stop thinking like scientists. They had to start thinking like politicians, because any halfway decent scientist would look at it and say, that's not possible. That couldn't work.
You'll kill them all. I very much agree with you, Alan. I've been watching you for years. You're very much precise on every of your points. They're very nice thinking, concise thinking. I have to congratulate you always on your presentations. All the channel has done a marvelous job. But they will derealize in a few years when nothing computes. They haven't sorted out the shielding yet. Everything starts falling apart. So you are doing them a favor and they don't know it. So it's as you said, you're pulling away the Santa Claus dream. And it had to be done at some point.
Yeah.
They're still getting a present under the tree, aren't they? Their imagination is being fulfilled by NASA. The only difference that you need to do is say, it's not reality. This is what we would like to be able to do and involve their imagination. Given the fact that they've got the largest movie production studios in the world, says a lot. I mean, it's a money-making proposition because they're going to show people on Mars, walking around on Mars, because they're spending $3.5 billion on a zero-gravity simulator.
The amount of effort they have put into all that lunacy, if they had put it in something worth it, we would be a much better world off. We would be much better off. There are how many technologies being suppressed, like the Edison battery. We have batteries that are immortal. They should be focusing on that. We all focused on producing solar cells. Now you can get like 2,000 watts for £200, £200, which is quite nice. there are too many technologies, like the batteries, which are being suppressed. They could be putting their efforts in trying to help people around. They have found the easy way out. The easy way out is to present fiction and get paid for that in real money. Disgrace for a scientist.
Have you seen some of the articles that are published on the Owlis website?
I've seen some, yes. So I'm a bit epidemically on a few stuff here and there. I love your magazine, Marcus. It's quite nice.
Thank you. We'll keep publishing it because a lot of people like it around the world.
You have very interesting subjects always and very presentable. They're very happy to have you around, Marcus.
I mean, I've been doing this, what, 30-odd years now? Ever since I appeared on a TV show with David Percy and Mary Bennett and a few others. Back in 1997, I think it was. That was when David was launching his book, Dark Moon. And when he explained why it was called Dark Moon, specifically, that's when it started to come together, and I started getting it. And then looking at the Apollo 13 story, which is a very interesting story, the Russians finding the Apollo command module floating in the Bay of Biscay, what was it doing there? Nobody reported it missing. And suddenly they found it, hauled it out, and took it back to Murmansk, and then handed it over to America. It's still on display now. That's the only mission that has two command modules on display.
This amount of competence only reminds me of my country, you know, Greece. Only we could have pulled this kind of level of incompetence. it's amazing for me. Here in Greece, NASA it has a name. It's called MASA. You know, eating like there is no tomorrow, MASA.
As we said before, we're all enthusiasts about human space travel, but we want it to be real. We want to be able to prove that humans can do what we're told they have done. We can now demonstrate that they haven't done it. So the whole thing is a fantasy. And if you've ever heard any of the comments made by Rasa Vihari on one of the Apollo Detectives series produced by Ben Emlyn-Jones and Neil Peel, he works for the Chinese Space Agency. And he says, nobody in China believes that anybody's landed on the moon. We know they haven't. And the Chinese are now doing a great deal of work pushing their own technology forward. And they're doing the best they can. But they're not going to put humans there until they can ensure they can survive.
Marcus, let's go very far away. I was at the university. Our university has 20,000 students. In the electrical and electronics engineering, I had 300 students. At some point, I was looking at one of your videos, and my supervisor comes in, and it's like, professor, you know, we haven't talked about this, but you know, do you actually believe that the Americans went to the moon in the 60s? He started laughing. Every country that has any physics people will be able to start immediately laughing. You know, okay, sometimes you don't process, but once you start processing, those things are apparent, like, you know, day to night. You cannot not see them. You cannot not spot the flag being still wet. You cannot unsee that. You cannot see the missing hole and the limb. You cannot unsee not a speck of dust. You cannot unsee the Kubrick line in every single one of those films. And especially in some films, they go towards a wall. And, you know, it's so apparent it's a wall. And they stop there. It's like, we don't have anything to explore here. And they turn around. Who are they kidding? The kids at the university. I always welcomed all the kids to my lab. All the kids, any questions that they had, they were always welcome. They were always, you know, to ask anything beyond the amount of physics they were teaching them there. You know, anything, you know, from atomic physics to anything they wanted to ask. And one of the things that I would always ask them is that nobody would believe it. Nobody. If you don't believe me, I can go around the university, a few videos taken, and you will see, you know, every and each of one of all the Greek students. So yes, it's not only Chinese, it's everyone.
That's a good point. It seems to be spreading. I mean, maybe America is the last country that will go along with it, because they're so invested in the story. You know, I watched it live on television. No, they watched animations. The National Academy of Simulation and Animation. That's what they watched, not a real landing. That came later because the film hadn't got back from the moon, we're told. They had to wait. and then the astronauts going in for 3 weeks of quarantine in case they brought lunar germs back with them. And then they go to the press conference and they look like they're at a funeral. It's sad. It really is very sad that honorable men, they are honorable men, they were doing the very best job they could, but they were caught up in this fantasy.
Yeah, they had to lie to a country they love. Should they feel happy that they were paid to play act that is going to be held a lie? They had signed any kind of advanced kind of, you know, big corporation. You do sign some deals, you have to keep your mouth shut in some
non-disclosure agreements.
Yeah, imagine having to have, you know, this kind of scenario. You are a man of integrity, you are in the military, you love your country, and you have to lie to everyone under God. Of course it was a funeral. Kind of blind at this point. Okay, in the 60s, like, only a few brains scattered around the earth, being versed enough in photography, the fall off of the light, which was a bit crazy even at the time. Yeah. But not many people were to be able to gather together as we do now from across the globe and scrutinize everything. So yes, they don't have the time they do think they have. The whole world knows. Ο κόσμος το έχει πάνω, the whole world knows.
That's true. And we've seen it recently with Artemis, haven't we?
Yes, and this is something else the whole world should take notice of too, is that this is the side of the moon that we see from Earth, and yet the Earth is over here. These people on the Earth, of which is us, should be seeing the dark side of the moon, because there is the side of the moon that we see. You see, things like this are impossible. And I thought that it was bad enough when I saw the other one, starting with the Earth here, and then moving across, and it vanishes behind. Now, we see it coming out the other side for once. So it has actually gone from here all the way down there to the other side. Well, let's just have a look and see if the moon's rotated at all. Nope. No, it's still in the same place, which means that this moon is backwards. This should be the dark side, and what we see on the Earth should be the near side, what we're seeing here, but it's backwards. This is the second time we've caught this now.
If you look at the capsule that splashed down,
it has tiles from the heat shield all the way up to the windows and past the windows.
That's right. They're heat shield tiles from the space shuttle. They're 3 inches thick, and they can withstand the sort of temperatures that we're told exist.
Did you also notice with the tiles that the ones around the windows are as baked as the ones that are a part of the heat shield? The material that they used from the heat shield, which they dredged up from the Apollo era, it now works. Well, it always did work, so they said, but now they're adding these space shuttle tiles to this 55-year-old magic formula that supposedly is a blat of material, and then it comes up and it goes up, 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 then it stops at the shield, of course, then it goes higher. Now we get into space shuttle tiles. So now we get into, there's two different eras of materials here, and both are baked. Now, why don't we see that on any of the Apollo command modules? Why don't we see any of the top part around the door baked? Why are those aluminum handles still attached to that command module? That's just impossible, because if that was the case with Artemis, then they should have had heat tiles all the way around that Apollo command module, or else those handles would have burned right off, and they're still there.
Well, they're still there because they were dropped out of an aircraft. It doesn't generate very much heat, does it?
I have been considering the parachutes alone. There are videos out there showing how those chutes are packed. They're using like a 20-ton press to compress these down to form them in to fit them. So it's very, very tightly packed together. They're out there for 12 days. They're coming back in through the heat, and we just listen to vacuum and heat and all kinds of stuff, right? Is that material going to cold weld itself together and turn into a single block? It's a good possibility.
Yeah, it is.
So they're going to open it up, and they're just going to have this block sitting there. When you really think about it, it's a material. Even with the flag, I mean, the off-gassing, and I'm going to ask Bill, Do you think the off-gassing on the flag would pull the color out of the material?
No, the color is quite solid. The colors generally are oxides of metals, so that they are already quite resilient. It's copper oxides for red, cobalt oxides for different colors.
So the nylon would off-gas quicker than the color?
The water would outgas. It would immediately evaporate. There is no possibility, there is no way to see something wet in a vacuum. Yeah. It would outgas. It would immediately evaporate.
Even if it was motor oil?
Oil evaporates, but in a much, 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 much slower rate.
Well, it took 3 days to get there.
Yeah, we have to see the partial pressure, it's called, to see how much it likes to evaporate. Everything likes to evaporate. Everything at some point, if it's liquid, it will evaporate.
If it was on the moon, it couldn't possibly be wet.
It cannot.
Water can't be there. I mean, you're only looking at 70,000 feet and water's going to boil off. And yes. Now you're down to 10 to the minus 11. So that photograph could not be taken on the moon. And that is a fact.
A very good eye. I could be watching those photographs for ages and would never have seen it. And once you see it, it's so apparent.
Nobody's seen it in 50 years. That's the part that gets me.
They were counting on this, Scott. They were counting on this. Who would have thought in the 60s that everyone would be interconnected? Yeah. Nobody. Even now that you go to purchase, the originals, you find it hard to get anything from NASA.
How do you know you're getting the originals?
Yeah, but of course, if you go to that thief and you ask for proof, they're going to give you whatever they like. They're making it hard. They made it hard initially anyways. They gave the world the second, third copies. You wouldn't be able, as Marcus was pointing out, once, he was able to find some copies through a magazine. I remember you were saying that. Yeah, they were trying to hide up everything. But now it's much worse for them, much worse. Because it's not only a few people here and there. There are scientists. There are a lot of people that are do find some notion in truth and some value and being liberated. It's true liberty to be able to talk your mind and the truth. It's true liberty, and especially as a scientist, you have to always think of where your work ends up and how your work is being used. And what is your general, ideology? You cannot be a scientist and, be like Fauci.
I like that. Don't mention gain of function.
It is under the same category. It goes against the message. What was the message? It was, now the new message is going to be, oh, the planet is dying off. The previous message was, oh, you're all going to die off. We went to the moon, although we were trying to make rockets better. Nothing to do with space. If you were to go to space, you would have to utilize that we are in an ocean of air. You would have to be utilizing as the British did some centuries ago. If you remember, Marcus, from your history, you're in the UK, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I did my first degree there, up in Leeds. And you had the canals, and you were transferring goods over the canals, because there is no friction, yeah? Well, you can utilize the same with balloons. You can fill up balloons, and you can go up to a certain altitude at which you can have thrusters that are made from plasma, which are much more efficient, but it's very hard for them to make them work in atmospheric pressure. So if I were to rethink everything, I would be not going around rockets. They went around the rockets because they were trying to improve their military things they had. If you are going to go to space, you will utilize a balloon, and then you will be launched from that base, from a base that is flying, you will be launching stuff with plasma thrusters. And that way, the energy you need is almost nothing. So, yes, it seems that there is not a lot of people thinking outside the box. Generally, when you do get scenario like this, it means that they are not really worried about what's going on or where the research is going. They really care about the money. Tell me something that is new from the 60s.
James Van Allen, what he did, he put these raccoons on balloons and then sent them up. So what he did was he was putting these sensors onto weather balloons and then attaching the sensors to the rocket, and then when the balloon took it up high enough, they fired the rocket, and then the rocket took it up the rest of the way. Yeah, it's the same idea.
Yeah, if you start from principles, that's the way to do it. If you utilize everything to your advantage. When you design, you have to holistically look at the problem because this is the only way to get to the best possible solution. You have to think and you have to look at all the parameters and how to use them. And generally, you have to think out of the box. Okay, one person may have had an idea, but it's not always, you know, the best idea. So it's always nice to have a few different ideas going along, seeing which one is the best in the end.
Okay, Bill, let me ask you a question. If NASA approached you openly and said, look, we screwed up badly with Apollo, we want to get it right now, what would you suggest that they do as the first step?
As the first step, I would suggest we look at the superconductors and supermagnets so as to have a proper shielding, first of all. Secondly, I would be looking at walls, you know, utilizing water or the sewage we are going to be having on our spacecraft, a few things there. And of course, the propulsion. One good propulsion they could be using is actually used in plasma torches at the moment. What happens is, if you have to make a spark, suppose you have two electrodes, 1 centimeter of distance apart. The electricity cannot jump from one electrode to the other easily because the air is an insulator. However, given enough voltage, you can persuade the electricity to jump over. It wants to travel through material easier, you know, if you put the pressure up. If you are to make a strong plasma, you have a problem because you have to fight the resistance you have in the atmosphere. Then, in order to have high amperage as well, you would have to have a lot of wattage. What they do is listen to this trick. They do get a spark through high voltage, like 100,000 volts. And once you do get a spark, that air is ionized. That air has free energy carriers, so it becomes conductive. If you blow it, and then you have another set of electrodes, but with lower voltage, but with higher amperage, equating to the same amount of wattage, low watt. You lower the voltage, you higher the amperage, you get the same kind of wattage. You don't high voltage, high amperage to have a requirement of high wattage. On the first stage, you have high voltage to ionize the air, and on the second stage, you do get a very high amperage power supply. Since the air is already conductive, when it passes through the high amperage electrodes, it gets hot. It gets really hot and really ionized. It gets to a really good plasma. That is the thruster I would be using. I haven't seen many utilizing this principle. We do have it. It's used in plasma torches or plasma cutters. The problem with putting it in airplanes is that thing behind leaves a combination of nitric oxides. He associates the air molecules. The air molecules are primarily nitrogen, two nitrogens together and two oxygens together. And if you put enough energy to create a plasma, all those molecules disassemble, they pyrolyze kind of. They disassemble, they have enough energy to all the atoms to be on their own, and they become reactive species. They want to again bond with something. So sometimes it so happens that an oxygen bonds with a nitrogen and becomes nitric oxide, or it becomes any kind of combination.
Yeah.
You could have. So that kind of thruster wouldn't be nice for our atmosphere, for airplanes. That'd be good thruster for space. It has very good efficiencies. If I were to have the NASA, I would prefer being at SpaceX, basically. But if I were to be somewhere to be advancing space, yeah, I would be looking at very basic stuff. Rockets are if you are to send a payload somewhere fast along the air. it's for military applications. It's not for space applications. They were giving the people the impression that they were looking at the advancements of humanity, and they were actually looking at a big exhibition of the America and their weapons for Russians to see out clearly. This the whole display. It was not a peaceful display. It was a display of military power, to my opinion, anyway. The time has passed.